Hey guys, welcome back to Learn Python the Hard Way. In this exercise, exercise 50, we are going to create our own first website and we are going to learn about Flask, which is a micro framework that we can use to facilitate creating web applications. So this is close to the end of the Learn Python the Hard Way program, and this exercise and the two subsequent exercises will be more extensive. And ideally, we should take a little bit more time to work on them. In general, we are going to use our virtual environment to install Flask and to work out of it, similar to how we did that in the previous exercises. So in order to do that, we first of all need to activate our virtual environment. And depending on whether you are using Linux, macOS, or Windows, the commands are slightly different. So if you're using Linux or macOS, as I am here, what we're going to do is open our terminal, and then we are going to execute the command to actually activate our virtual environment. And once we have done that, we can see that we activated our virtual environment since we have the current directory here in front in parentheses. If instead you're using Windows, you can use Microsoft PowerShell here, and the command is similar but slightly different. You will have the same effect that you basically create that virtual environment. Now, once we are inside of that virtual environment, we can continue by actually installing Flask. And as we did before, we are still going to use pip to install our packages, and in this case, to install Flask. So Flask is a web framework, and the term framework basically means some package that makes it easier for us to do something. So there are some predefined configurations and a certain setup that's already in place for us, so it makes it a lot easier to build on top of. And since there can be a lot of edge cases and a lot of specific scenarios that we want to deal with in terms of creating a web application, using such a framework can save a lot of time. And of course, there are a number of different frameworks available to us. Flask is rather lightweight, a rather small framework. But another kind of popular one for Python is Django, which is a little bit more powerful. But for now, Flask is a very good starting point. So in order to install Flask inside of our virtual environment, what we need to do is basically execute this command here. So if we are on Linux or macOS, we can simply type in sudo pip install flask, and that's going to install Flask for us. I already installed it ahead of time, but if you execute that command, you will see that Flask is actually installed, including some dependencies, and then we can use it in order to write our web application. If you're using Windows, you can execute a similar command from PowerShell. You can basically just type in pip install flask, and this will install Flask for you. Now, once Flask is installed, we can create a simple structure for our Flask application. So first of all, we need to switch over to our projects directory that we created in some of the previous exercises. And then we need to create a new directory here called Gozon Web for our web application, switch inside of that web application and create a number of different folders that we're going to use. So for instance, we are creating a Gozon Web folder here and also a tests folder that we can use going forward. And there are some things that are more specific to Flask, for example, a templates folder, which we are going to use in a bit. So I already created the Gozon Web folder, so we can just switch into that. And if we take a look at the different directories in here, we have a nice little structure here with the different folders that we can use for our Flask application. We also need to make sure that we create an init file inside of Gozon Web and inside of our tests folder, just in terms of the basic structure. If you're using Windows instead, the commands are slightly different, but we are still taking the same steps and creating the same directories basically and the same files. Once we created that structure, we can get started by creating our Flask application. And in order to do that, we basically need to create a new Python file called app.py inside of the folder we just created. So basically, we should create this file here, app.py. And inside of that file, we want to import Flask as a module here. Then we are going to create this variable here that basically holds our Flask application. And then we have a method in here called hello world, which is connected to a route here. We are using a Python decorator to refer to the root path. And inside of our function here, we have a variable called greeting that just stores the value world. And then we are going to return hello, and we replace greeting with world in here. So that's basically the structure we have in here. And at the bottom, we have the command app run. So that's the basic structure we need in order to create a web application using Flask. So let's switch over. I'm using Visual Studio Code. So I'm going to type in code followed by app.py. And this is going to create or open a new file. I already created it ahead of time. And you need to fill out the relevant information. Now, once we have saved this file, what we need to do is to basically run our application. And we can do that again from the terminal. Inside of our directory here, we can run python app.py. And if we execute that, we can basically see that we are now running our Flask application on this URL here. So on this particular IP address and port 5000, which is the default port we are using in development mode. Now, following that link here, we can take a look at what that actually looks like. And we now see a local web application, which prints out hello world. So at this point, we already have our application up and running. And we can always see that if we access our web application here, we can also see that in our terminal now. So we can see we started a GET request to actually see that we accessed, that we requested that particular web page. And those log files that we see inside of our terminal are printed out by Flask so that we can see that our server is working. And we can also see what the browser is doing behind the scenes. And that will also be helpful if we encounter some error, some issue. We can use whatever we get back on the terminal to debug any error that we encounter. And we will take a closer look of how this actually works and what happens behind the scene in some of the subsequent exercises. But just to get a high-level overview, here's basically what happens when we are accessing our web application. So first of all, our browser makes a network connection to our own computer, which is called localhost. And that is basically the standard way of saying whatever our own computer is called on the network. And that uses port 5000. And actually, this IP address you can see here, 127.0.0.1, is basically equivalent to localhost. So instead of typing the IP address, we could also type localhost. And that should basically give us the same page here. So that's the first step. That's the request that our browser makes. We try to access that on port 5000. So once it connects, it makes an HTTP request to the app.py application and ask for the root URL, which is basically the default URL on any website. And this is basically where we switch over to our application code here. And we can see we have this decorator here, app.route. So what should happen when we access that root here? So inside of app.py, we have a list of URLs and what functions they match. So the only one we have is basically that root page here. We're going to see an example of using index soon, but that basically means that whenever we access the root page so localhost 5000 slash basically, then we get back whatever is defined in the function associated with that root URL. So in this case here, using app.route, this is our root, and when we access that, then this particular method here will be executed, so index, and that's basically where we define that variable world, and then we return back to the browser basically hello, comma, and then we render whatever is in greeting, which is world, which is why we get back hello, comma, world. Well, the next step, now that Flask has found def index, or in our case here, actually I think in the example it's called def hello world. It doesn't really matter what we call it at this point, it still works basically the same. Once we encounter that, then it calls it to actually handle the request, and the function runs and simply returns a string for what Flask should send to the browser, which is the return statement we just saw. And then eventually Flask has handled the request and sends this response to the browser, which is what we are seeing on the page. So these are basically the five different steps that are executed when we start a request from our browser. Now, if we encounter any errors in our code, so if we maybe made a mistake, then we can see those errors in our terminal. So if we switch over to our code here, and let's say we are removing the line here, the greetings variable, like this, and we save this change, now we are trying to return this string here, and we are referencing a variable that doesn't exist, so we should encounter an error. Let's just quickly take a look at that, and in order to do that, let's briefly terminate the connection here, which you can do by pressing Ctrl C, and then we can run Python app.py again. So far we're not getting an error, but if we try to access that page again, we now see we get an internal server error, which is not that descriptive, but if we take another look at our terminal, we can see that we have a number of different error messages here showing up, and here at the bottom we see that we are trying to starting a GET request and we get a 500 error back. And just above that we can see the actual cause of the error, so the name greeting that we are referencing in here is actually not defined. So that can be very helpful to take a look at the terminal to see what the issue, what the error is. That works pretty well, but there's an even better way to do that. We can activate the debugger mode inside of Flask, and that can help us basically print that out in a better way and to make it a little bit clearer what the actual error is. So in order to do that, we need to end our connection here again, and then we can run export flask underscore debug and set that equal to 1. And now we can run Python app.py again, so basically to restart our server. And we can see here, we actually started our debugger now, so we are going to get more information. And if we now head over to our web page and reload it, we now get a more descriptive page back. So here we can see right away in our browser window that the name greeting is not defined, so we can directly see that within our browser. And if we take a look at the terminal, we can still see that information in our terminal as well. So that can be very helpful to get an overview and directly see within the browser what the issue is and what the problem is. But we need to be a little bit careful because we should never use such debugger information in an actual production environment, since if we do that, then somebody who attacks our server, who tries to maybe corrupt our application, may get access to some information that we don't want to make available. Because if we take a look at that here, the actual error is visible here, and we can also see some traceback here of the actual code, for example here, that is printed in here, so an attacker would have more information to actually compromise the security of our web application. So therefore, we should always make sure that we avoid using Flask debug on a production server and definitely deactivate that when we use it in production. Now we got our basic application up and running, but it's very simple. So we just printed out a single line, which also wasn't formatted properly. So to make that look a little bit nicer, we can get started working with templates and format it properly in a correctly displayed HTML page. And to do that, we are going to create a new folder, or actually we are going to use the templates folder that we created before. And inside of that folder, we are going to create a new HTML file called index.html, which has a basic HTML structure. You can see that because we are starting our page here with the HTML tag and also ended that way. And then we have a head section here and the body section. And inside of the body section here, we have still the code we are printing out. So hello world, for instance, but we also have some styling going on here. So we are using some CSS to style our page in line. And you can see here, we have those brackets here, basically those curly braces. And this is a templating engine that we are using called Ginger 2, that in the background we can use to insert some logic directly into our HTML page. And here we can see we basically have an if statement. So if we have a value for the variable greeting, then we want to print out this. If greeting is none, it's not defined, then instead we should return hello world. So let's do that. Let's switch over to our terminal. And if we take a look at our templates folder, we can see that we have index.html in there. So let's open that in our code editor just to take a closer look. So here we can see our template defined just the same way as over here. And now, of course, we need to make sure that we actually are using that template inside of our web application. And one important point to mention, you can see here inside of those double curly braces, we have that variable greeting. So in every place where we see this with the two opening and two closing curly braces, that basically means that we will pass a variable here to our template that alters the content of the page. So whatever is stored in greeting, which for instance in app.py before we assigned greeting to world, then greeting would be replaced. So if we want to insert some values of a variable, we would actually use those two opening and closing curly braces. So in order to actually use our template, we need to make some changes to our app.py, to our Flask application. So first of all, we are going to change the name of the method here from currently hello world over to index. So we basically want to make sure that we are using exactly the same name as we define inside of our template code here. So if we name it index.html, then we should name that method index. Now let's create greeting again as a variable, and we are going to call it hello world. And now we are using something new. We are not going to return the string directly as we did here, but instead we are going to render a template. And here we're passing in index.html, which is the page we just created. And we are also going to pass over the value for the greeting variable here over to index.html, so it can be passed and can be used inside of our template. And in order to use render underscore template, we actually need to import that. So we need to import that as a module from Flask again. So here at the very top, we need to type from Flask import render template. And once we have done that, we can switch over here and say we want to return render underscore template and pass to it index HTML and also greeting, which we are going to set to the value of greeting. And we don't necessarily have to use the same variable name here. This basically just means that whatever we assign here to greeting, that will be used inside of the template. So we could call this variable something else, for example, ABC, and then basically set greeting equal to ABC. But it's a lot clearer if it has the same name here. All right, so let's save this change here. And let's restart our server by typing again Python. Oh, and we also should make sure that we are inside of our root folder here. So we need to navigate up one level and then run Python app.py. And let's take another look at our website here. And yeah, we said that we configured that correctly. So now we can see we type out, I just wanted to say hello world. And here we're using CSS to style hello world. So if you take a look at index.html, here we have the greeting variable, which of course is equal to hello world. And by using some CSS, we are setting the color to green, and we are also adjusting the font size. So this is how we can use some templates and then render the correct information. Now, and in addition to adjusting, for example, the styling, the color, and the font size, this is now also valid HTML, which we can see by going back to our website web page here, right clicking, and then selecting View Page Source. We can take a look at the underlying HTML, and now we can see we have valid HTML, which is basically exactly the same as we have here in our template. The only difference is that basically all the logic here, so if greeting, else, and if, that's basically rendered. So it's not visible inside of our web application, but because greeting had a value, we just take whatever was in the if statement here and ignore all the rest. That's why here in the HTML file we see, I just wanted to say, and then we have the style here. And of course also greeting is replaced with hello world, which is why we see hello world in here. But this is now valid HTML, which is great. So we also have the correct structure in place. So let's take a closer look at what actually happens here. So inside of app.py, we have imported a new function named render template from our Flask module. So this is what we are doing here on top. So this render template is predefined, and that knows how to load HTML files out of the template directory. So that's basically some magic that Flask provides. It automatically knows where to basically pull that information from. So when we call render template and we pass index.html to it, it automatically knows to take a look at the templates folder and take a look at the file there. So that's the default setting for a Flask application. So later in our code, when the browser hits the dev index section, so here where we define our method, what's happening here, instead of just returning the string greeting as we did previously, we now call render template and pass the greeting to it as a variable, as we are doing right here. And this call to render template then loads the index.html file inside of the templates folder. Again, this is some magic that is basically happening behind the scene, which is a default configuration for any Flask application. And in this index.html template file, we basically have our HTML included, but the code that we placed between those markers is basically rendered. And whenever we have opening curly braces and then this percent sign, that means we have some executable code, for example, if statements, or we could use loops, so on and so forth. And when we have those double opening and double closing curly braces, then we know that we need to render that, and that rendered output is then shown on the web page. And what is used in the background here, which is actually the default for Flask, is Jinja 2. There's a separate documentation for that, so we can take a look at what is supported. We also have, of course, different examples for that, but this is the underlying templating engine that is being used to basically render any logic and it's basically the default using that we use for Flask applications. So to get a little bit deeper into that, we can change the greeting variable and see what that does to our HTML page. So if we head back to our file here and we change hello world to maybe hello there, we save that. We need to briefly stop our server and restart it. And now it should happen that instead of seeing hello world, it should actually display hello there. So let's reload the page. We see it has been updated. So just by changing that variable here, we basically change the content of our web page. And we should also create another template named, for example, templates/food.html, and we can also render that as before. So to do that, let's just briefly terminate our server here, and we can say we want to open or create foo.html. Of course, we need to create that inside of our templates folder again, and then we can create a basic structure here. So I already created a basic structure ahead of time. So here we can see if message, let me just remove that for now. If message, then we can, for example, print out message provided, else we can print out no message. And of course, we could also turn that into valid HTML here by, for example, changing that to a paragraph. Like this. So let's save that. Now we created our second template file, foo.html. In order to use it inside of our application, what we need to do is we basically want to use a separate route. So we can say we want to use the route maybe /foo to display that. Let's define a new function, we can call it foo as well. And now we can, for example, say that we want to use a variable called message. And then again, we would say return render template. This time, of course, we want to render foo.html. And then, for example, we can pass to it message. And message is just the variable that we're using inside of that. So let's save those changes here. And let's rerun our application. Now, if we reload the page, then by default, of course, we would end up on the default route here, which is this one, which of course still renders index.html. But what we changed now is if we instead access /foo, then we should actually end up on the other page. So now we can see if we access /foo, then this method here will be executed and we return the other template in foo.html. And here, since a value for message is provided, we return message provided. And again, we can check using view page source that this is actually a valid HTML page, which it is indeed. So this is how we can add additional templates. And of course, we could add as many as we'd like and basically create separate routes to access those different pages. And this is basically the basic approach we would take when creating a web application, a web page using Flask, by defining those different routes and inside of those or just below those, set up the different methods. And then use render template, for example, to render several templates, which we can set up in the separate templates folder. So let's take a look at some of the study drills here. The first one is to actually read up on the Flask documentation. And let's do that here. So on the Flask web application, we can see some more information about Flask, of course. So here we can also find links to Ginger, which is the templating engine we just saw. And we have a user guide here covering the installation that we already did before. And then a quick start with different sections. We have some tutorials that go into more advanced topics here. We can see how we can test a Flask application. And also if we take a look a little bit further down here, also how to basically scale an application. So if you want to have a larger application, how we would handle that, and how we could basically scale up our application if we would like. So there's also documentation about that. Next, let's experiment with some of the aspects that we find there, including the example code. So if we go back to the Flask webpage here, we can, for example, take a look at rendering templates. So we can see of some of the examples we saw before. So if we import the render template method here from the Flask module, then we can use render template to render any of those pages here. We already saw that before, and we have a lot of additional options. We can use a file upload, for example. We can work with cookies to store some information and then basically store that in the browser when we exit it later on. And we can also create redirects. So if we take a look at that, for instance, here we are importing, for example, the redirect method from the Flask module, and then we can redirect certain routes to other routes. So in this example here, for example, when we access the root route, then we are using redirect and URL4 to redirect to the login page. So if we take that as a template, as a basis, we can just hop over to our code. And for example, we could say that when we access the root route, like this, where we currently see this page, maybe we want to forward that, redirect that to our foo template that we just created. So in that case, we would go ahead and taking a look at the documentation here, we first of all need to make sure that we import those methods from Flask. So let's import redirect and also URL4. And now when we access our root here, basic root, then let's just remove this for now. And instead we can say we want to return a redirect, and we pass in URL4 foo. Let's save this. And let's restart our server. Let's see if that worked correctly. So here, if we reload this page, what we expect is to be forwarded to the foo page. And indeed, that's what's happening. And also when I'm trying to access the root page again, we are automatically forwarded, redirected to our foo template page. So that's just one example how we can use the Flask documentation to implement some additional capabilities. Of course, there's a lot more, and we could take a closer look at that depending on the application we want to build. That can be very helpful as a reference. Next, let's read about HTML5 and CSS3 and make some additional HTML and CSS files for practice. So HTML is generally used for marking up our web page. So we would basically declare what we display on the web page. So it's really all about form. And CSS is used for presentation, so how we want to display whatever we show on the page. So for example, if you want to show something centered, or if you want to add any color to it, that would be covered by CSS. So in order to do that, let's switch back to our terminal here, and let's just abort the server for now. So in general, when we are working with styles with Flask, we would typically create a separate static folder here. And then inside of that static folder, if we just switch over to it, we create a styles subfolder. And inside of that, we can then create our styles. So here, for example, we have styles.css, which is a CSS file. We just take a look at that. It's a very simple file, where we basically just define the background color for the page and set it to light blue. And then we can also change the styling here for our paragraphs that we are using. So in this case, we adjust the font family and we increase the font size to 20 pixels. So that's basically how we can set up our style sheets. And it's best practice to do that in a separate CSS file rather than doing what we did before here. So this inline approach is generally not recommended. It can be good for testing purposes, but it can be very hard to maintain if you want to, for example, change, different parts of the page to a different color. When we are using a separate external CSS file, we can just change that in one place and it will be updated wherever we are using that. If you're doing that inline, of course, it becomes a lot more difficult to do, and also the template file itself becomes more difficult to actually read. So let's actually style our foo template page. And to do that, we of course need to still reference our styles, style sheet here. Okay, in order to do that, what we basically want to do is we want to use the link tag here to reference a style sheet, and then we can link to that using an href tag. And here we're using URL4. We're referencing static, which is a folder in which we actually have our CSS file, and then we can add the file name. So in our case, it would be in the styles folder, and we actually called it styles.css. Let's save this change. And then we can switch over and restart our application here. And we always need to make sure that we are inside of the correct directory. So again, we are going to run python app.py. Let's go back to our page here, reload it, and now we can see we actually applied those CSS styles. So the background here is changed to light blue. We also changed the font type and the font size. So that's how we can use CSS and styling inside of Flask. And finally, if we know somebody who knows Django, which is another framework, which is a little bit more powerful and is willing to help, then we can consider doing this exercise and the two subsequent ones using Django instead of Flask. For now, we are going to use Flask because it's a very lightweight application that's actually very good for these smaller kind of websites. Let's take a look at some common student questions. So the first one is that user can't seem to connect to localhost 5000. If that's the case, then you can just access that website using the IP address. So localhost is basically equivalent to this particular IP address, again on port 5000, and then we should be able to access our web page. I can't find index.html or just about anything. If that's the case, then we are probably inside of an existing directory, for example, the bin directory. And we should make sure that we execute the commands from above the directory, so basically from the root directory of our project. And there we can type python app.py, and this is then going to start our web application. Why do we assign greeting to greeting when we call the template? So actually, we are not assigning to greeting. We are setting a named parameter to give to the template. So that's sort of an assignment, but it only affects the call to the template function. So if we take a look again here to, for example, app.py, this is an example here. We are passing message here, which is a named parameter, hello, over to message, which is then the variable being used inside of our template. And here we are using that variable again. So that's basically how we pass information over from our Python application over to the template we are using. And finally, I can't use port 5000 on my computer. So if that's the case, then we probably have an antivirus program installed that is using that port. In that case, we can try a different port. All right, that's it for exercise 50, and see you guys next time with exercise 51.